This is Stewart Patrick. On this installment of The Internationalist, we'll explore the emerging powers beyond the BRICS and how their rise could affect the global balance of power. The international system is traditionally described as developed versus developing, east versus west, north versus south. In reality, the world is much more complex, dynamic, and interconnected. More than 10 years have passed since Goldman Sachs economist Jim O'Neill coined the term BRICS to describe the four emerging powers he predicted would drive future global economic growth: Brazil, Russia, India, and China. In 2009, the BRICS became a formal economic and political grouping, much like the OECD, G8, or G20. In April 2011, South Africa formally joined the founding four and began participating in its annual summits. There's no doubt that the BRICS are an economic force. By 2030, they should pass the advanced market democracies of the OECD in economic output. The big question is whether this diverse group of countries will translate its growing economic clout into political power or remain a catchy acronym. The closer you look, you realize there's not much mortar binding these BRICS in terms of common interests. While they might align on a few issues, like the role of the dollar, they collide on other matters, such as the value of democracy. And the group is strained by geopolitical rivalries, particularly between China and India. More fundamentally, focusing just on the BRICS distracts us from dramatic growth elsewhere in the developing world. Beyond the BRICS, a middle tier of countries is emerging as an engine of rapid growth, surging consumer demand, and expanding trade. Here's a little known fact. Goldman Sachs has recently identified its next 11 countries after the BRICS. They're Bangladesh, Egypt, Indonesia, Iran, South Korea, Mexico, Nigeria, Pakistan, the Philippines, Turkey, and Vietnam. Collectively, the population of these countries is 1.3 billion. That's larger than India and nearly equal to China. And by 2030, just 18 years from now, the total GDP of these countries will likely surpass the 27 countries of the European Union. And by mid-century, their total economic weight should rival the G7 countries themselves. Of the batch, the main countries to watch are Turkey, Mexico, Indonesia, and South Korea. All are vibrant democracies with burgeoning market economies, growing populations, and to a certain extent, broader regional ambitions. Some have begun flexing their diplomatic muscle, as we've seen Turkey do in the Middle East, whether in the Israeli-Palestinian dispute or over Iran's nuclear program. Others are exploiting their economic prowess. South Korea is now a member of the OECD and has joined the club of aid donors, more than doubling its foreign assistance over the last decade. Mexico, meanwhile, has exercised leadership on climate change negotiations and, as the current host of the G20, has launched a negotiating track among G20 foreign ministers heading into this June summit in Los Cabos. Indonesia, the world's largest Muslim nation, is staking out a position of leadership within ASEAN, as well as in the Organization of Islamic Cooperation. Of course, each country faces unique domestic political challenges. Turkey is slowly granting broader rights to its Kurdish minority, although progress is halting. Mexico is struggling to turn the tide of massive drug violence. Indonesia is emerging from a past that's rife with religious and separatist struggles. And South Korea, of course, shares a border with an unstable North Korean regime. Despite these issues, projections for growth all point to the rise of a new crop of global powers aside from the BRICS. The growth of the emerging middle powers will have big implications for regional and international power structures and debates over how best to reform current mechanisms of global governance. Institutions like the World Bank, the International Monetary Fund, and the United Nations have all been criticized for having outdated governance structures that no longer reflect contemporary distributions of economic and political power. Consider the UN Security Council, whose permanent membership has not changed since 1945. At least three of the BRICS, Brazil, India, and South Africa, want to take permanent seats in an expanded council. But the rise of the second-tier countries complicates this prospect, because countries like Mexico, South Korea, Indonesia, and Pakistan know they will be losers in this process, while their regional rivals are the major contenders for new seats. So we can expect a lot more fights, not just between the established and the big emerging countries, but among countries in the developing world itself as to who gets the privileges of power. This brings us to the biggest unknown. Given the dramatic but uneven growth in the developing world, World Bank President Robert Zoellick is surely right when he notes that old frames like North and South no longer make much sense. What's unclear is whether the rise of new middle powers will help erode outdated blocs like the Non-Aligned Movement and the Group of 77 as coherent forces within the UN General Assembly and other forums. It's also unclear whether this second tier of emerging powers will be any more willing than the BRICS to assume global responsibility. Will they take the lead in addressing threats to international financial stability, global health, or peace and security? My prediction is that the world's emerging middle, the countries beyond the BRICS, will increase the diffusion of power and authority from the traditional world leaders. They may also accelerate the rise of regional and sub-regional organizations. The United States would do well to engage each of these emerging players on their own terms as potential partners and allies. Well, that's my view. What do you think? Join the debate on the Internationalist blog at cfr.org.